Cubane is becoming a frequently discussed top chemistry meme, but there is more here than meets the eye. Just like octanitrocubane, this interdisciplinary video will blow your mind as we unify various basic and advanced concepts that we've learned in previous videos. We have seen the pioneering swaggy use of the anti-aromatic cyclobutadiene in the synthesis of cubane and structural analysis of the highly strained ASA homocubane. But as most of you know, cubanes, just like bicyclopropanes, can also function as benzene isosteres for drug optimization. Trailblazing research has now made a class of underexplored cubanes accessible, and the chemists used this methodology to synthesize an analog of a cystic fibrosis drug, which seems quite innocent. However, the original molecule has an intriguing story as it is connected to a massive public upset around drug prices in the hundreds of thousands per year, leading to the inception of a buyer's club of parents who are procuring generic drugs made in Argentina on their own to avoid premium pricing. Oh, and negotiations took so long that over 300,000 tablets were ultimately thrown away as they had expired. So today's video will be a great opportunity to check out chemistry, but also learn about a major disease and its treatments. And just to make things even better, we will also see our friend deuterium again. So if you are clueless, I suggest you check out my other videos first to explore the mysteries of deuterium and ASA homocubane. Also, consider supporting the channel by becoming a member or Patreon. Thanks for tuning in and I hope you enjoy. So let's look at a random pharmaceutical such as elacestrant, the first oral selective estrogen receptor degrader recently approved by the FDA. Like many drugs, it contains flat apolar benzene rings. To harness additional binding interactions due to free dimensionality and to optimize pharmacokinetic properties like solubility or clearance while keeping overall geometry and structure intact, chemists are exploring various bioisostere groups. With over 350 patents, bicyclopentane or BCP is the most explored motif. However, it only directionally replicates benzene's size. Mimicking substitutions other than para-phenyl systems is also relatively challenging, although there were some recent advances by the likes of Phil Barron. On the other hand, the cube boy is emerging as another promising isostere as it closely replicates benzene's size and exit angle of substituents, as we will see soon. To throw in another isostere in the mix, there's cyclooctatetraene, which is slightly bigger, and surprisingly can be made from cubanes directly via rhodium-catalyzed isomerization. As we will see, this motif can outperform cubane in some cases as well. Let's focus first on the cubanes, analyzing the work of the MacMillan group, which tackled three key challenges in cubane synthesis. The first two are associated with the lengthy synthesis of cubanes that have non-linear substitution patterns, as these are not commercially available. The third challenge pertains to functionalization of cubane building blocks. As this is MacMillan here, you already know we're going to see some interesting applications of photochemistry. As a diligent viewer, you will remember the old-school use of cyclobutadiene generated from an iron complex to rapidly build cubane via successive 4+2 and 2+2 additions. I told you that chemists are still today looking for new ways of generating cyclobutadiene equivalents because those metal complexes are extremely inconvenient to prepare. It would be quite good not to have to worry about things like your filter residue catching fire spontaneously, so that's why this new research was very much needed. The first methodology is an electrocyclization extravaganza, which uses a much more accessible starting material. A first electrocyclization creates a four-membered cyclobutene. After nitrogen deprotection, a genius oxidation using this quinone then reveals a diazine which can release nitrogen to afford the cyclobutadiene. Why is the oxidation so smart? Well, it allows for a one-pot generation of cyclobutadiene followed by immediate Diels Alder reaction to enter the 1966 synthesis. So the reaction partner we need anyways can also be used as an oxidant. The rest of the synthesis proceeds as expected. Another 2+2 addition forms the core, and a double Favorsky reaction leads to ring contraction to the four-membered ring. Note that because the alpha position of the ketone is not enolizable due to Bredt's rule, this is actually a quasi-Favorsky reaction that proceeds through concerted migration of the alkyl bond to displace the bromide. A final double methylation rounds up this nice synthesis of the 1,3-diester. To apply the same logic to 1,2 substituted cubanes, you would start with a 1,2 bromo starting material so that both esters end up in a 1,2 relationship as well. The team found that while the first Favorsky reaction proceeds normally, the second one is actually stopped by a competing Haller-Bauer cleavage, shown with the arrow in pink. It's all guesses at this point, but the presence of the second ester in a beta position potentially stabilizes the resulting anion. To access 1,2 substituted cubanes nevertheless, they found that using the commercially available 1,4 diester in a light-mediated CH carboxylation introduced another ester in the desired 1,2 arrangement. Because the unwanted ester is sterically exposed, they were able to selectively hydrolyze it by using just one equivalent of sodium hydroxide. This allowed them to get to the free acid and decarboxylate it in two steps, leaving behind the desired 1,2 diester. They next wanted to use these building blocks in the assembly of bigger molecules. The problem here is that activated cubanes can't be readily coupled to other groups with typical cross-coupling catalysts, as these tend to favor cubane decomposition under strain release. One of the key decomposition mechanisms is oxidative addition, which is why MacMillan's previously reported dual copper photoredox catalysis seemed perfect for the cross-coupling with cubanes. Copper is known to undergo slow oxidative addition but rapid reductive elimination, which means that it might be less prone to lead to the unproductive valence bond isomerization pathway. Long story short, copper works great. The cool thing is that not only were they able to use amines to capture the cubane radical generated from photodecarboxylation, but they also optimized conditions to tolerate CC coupling with aryl and alkyl rests. Trifluoromethylation also works, which might be pretty handy for medicinal chemists trying this methodology out. We will not go step by step through the mechanism to manage time, but I wanted to highlight their development of a new aminosilane which not only reductively quenches the photocatalyst to prepare decarboxylation, but also generates the active radical via halogen abstraction which fuels the copper catalytic cycle. Back to our original point on isosteres, the special thing about these novel 1,2 and 1,3 functionalized cubanes is that they closely emulate ortho and meta substituted phenyl rings due to size and exit angles of substituents. The powerful conclusion to this new research was the synthesis of a cubane analog of Lumacaftor, a top-selling drug. Conveniently, it has a terminal free acid, so its synthesis via cross-coupling was quite simple. Incorporation of cubane as an isoster improved solubility significantly, particularly at acidic pH, which might enable improved absorption in the GI tract after oral administration of the drug. This might be due to modulation of the acid's pKa or disruption of pi interactions. In addition, the cubane analog has lower clearance, indicating higher metabolic stability. On the negative side, inhibitory activity decreased more than tenfold, probably because the substitution messes with the ionic interaction here in pink between the drug and its target, the CFTR ion channel. Ultimately, this is a question of trade-offs and what you want to optimize for. Before we pivot to better understand Lumacaftor, we should give two honorary mentions. First, we saw earlier that metal catalysis can undesirably decompose cubanes via oxidative addition. Some chemists intentionally optimized this pathway under rhodium-1 catalysis to convert cubanes into cyclooctatetraene analogs. Some researchers boldly claim that COT is a promising motif as it is more flexible than cubane or phenyl, but still can engage in pi interactions in a binding site. The analog of warfarin, a widely used anticoagulant, which you can see here in blue, had much greater inhibitory efficacy against various enzyme mutants. This shows isosteres don't always have to ruin activity, so maybe it's worth to convert cubane analogs to COTs and just check out what happens to their properties. The second honorary mention is research from Barron and co-workers, which made 1,2 disubstituted bicyclopentanes more accessible. Definitely check out this paper for another nice read. This example here mimics an ortho-substituted arene. Similar to what we saw with Cuba-Lumacaftor, solubility increased, but IC50 potency decreased more than 250-fold. Back to Lumacaftor and cystic fibrosis. CF is a severe rare genetic disease that affects around 90,000 people globally and is caused by mutations in the CFTR ion channel. If you know anything about biology, you will know that if you mess with ion channels, you mess with the cell's physiology big time. Defective or missing CFTR leads to abnormal ion transport, causing thick, sticky mucus. Most patients ultimately develop progressive lung disease despite intense symptomatic treatments like anti-inflammatory agents or mucolytics like Roche's Pulmozyme, all of which do not treat the molecular cause of the disease. Unfortunately, the median age of death is around 30 years old. The most common mutation present in around 90% of CF patients in the US is the deletion of phenylalanine at position 508, which causes processing abnormalities and leads to the protein getting lost somewhere in the cell. However, there are hundreds of other mutations also associated with CF. Another key one is the G551D missense mutation, which severely decreases the activity of the ion channel. The first revolutionary treatment in CF was Ivacaftor, a small molecule CFTR potentiator approved in 2012. Simply put, this molecule helps the ion channel to stay open for a longer time. Due to its mechanism, it was however only helpful for the few patients with less active ion channels. For the vast majority with the phenylalanine deletion, getting more activity doesn't help you at all, as the ion channels are still not properly localized to begin with. Fortunately, the manufacturer Vertex a few years later also developed correctors, which ensure that more proteins are brought to the cell membrane. The first of these is our beloved Lumacaftor, but a few years later there was also Alexacaftor, which as you might guess from its structure has a different binding site. Lumacaftor was later also outshined by another new next generation corrector called Tesacaftor. Because potentiators and correctors have different mechanisms, the best approach is to combine them into a single regimen. The triple combo resulted in Trikafta, Vertex's most recently launched brand, which can be used in patients with at least one phenylalanine deletion mutation and thus around 90% of patients. While the triple therapy might look a bit random to an outsider, the agent stacking really does make a difference. A large phase 3 clinical trial looked at triple therapy versus mono or dual therapy and observed significant benefit in terms of forced expiratory volume, a measure for lung function. Chloride concentration in sweat, which is a measure of the CFTR protein dysfunction, also decreased. Interestingly, the active controlled group didn't improve from baseline, but it's hard to tell what would have happened in the study population without treatment as they didn't have a placebo arm. Beyond this trial, real-world data has now shown that the drug leads to around 75% reduction in risk of death. Trikafta's strong efficacy leads to a rosy outlook for Vertex cystic fibrosis franchise, which is projected to drive more than $10 billion in sales by 2025. This is primarily due to the hefty price tag on these brands, with $300,000 cost per year per patient in the US. As this is prohibitively pricey for many, patients and advocates have pleaded with the company and governments to improve access for years already. Orkambi, the first-gen combo consisting of our molecule Lumacaftor, was approved in 2015 already. Ironically, negotiations between Vertex and UK health officials lasted so long that Vertex had to trash almost 8,000 expired packs in 2018. This stalemate led to parents of children with cystic fibrosis forming a buyer's club to purchase equivalent generic Orkambi manufactured in Argentina, where the Vertex patent does not apply. That generic is around 80% cheaper than the UK list price, unfortunately still unaffordable for many. The story is basically repeating itself with the launch of Trikafta now. The Argentinian manufacturer has since launched generic Trikafta, and more recently activists and patient advocacy groups have petitioned governments to revoke or suspend patents to support affordable generic supply. In parallel, Vertex just received a label expansion for Trikafta in the US to treat children as young as 2 years old compared to the previous minimum age of 6 years. Excluding the question around access, this is promising news for these children as early interventions are always better. Also quite recently, AbbVie, another pharma company, discontinued its own CFTR potentiator and corrector combo treatment, effectively leaving Vertex unchallenged for the time being. In the long term, other companies running early stage R&D might emerge as competitors for Vertex, particularly ones looking at RNA or curative gene therapies. We will not cover them here, but let me know if you would want to learn more in a future video. Vertex has a final late stage program for yet another combo, vanzacaftor and deuterium. How do these structures look like? Vanzacaftor, as you can see from its structure, is an optimized version of the corrector agent elexacaftor. Notably, the terbutyl group is replaced by this funky dispyro group. Deuterium, on the other hand, can you guess it? Is a deuterated analog of ivacaftor, the CFTR potentiator. If you watch my video on deuterium, you're already an expert. Deuteration of one of the terbutyl groups lead to significantly higher in vitro and in vivo stability. This is quite handy as ivacaftor needs to be taken twice a day, so the deuterium combo is probably efficacious with just a single daily dose. We've covered quite some ground in today's video, and I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please leave a like, subscribe, and consider becoming a channel member. See you in the next one.